don't all start in China, but nevertheless, most do, or many do. New boosters that are designed to target new variants. So we are doing exactly the thing that's going to make the virus evolve to avoid us, right? All bets are off. We'd be back at the beginning of the epidemic.
자, 날로 인기를 더해가고 있는 글로벌 모니터 오늘도 세계의 석학 한 분을 모시고 우리 사회의 현안을 살펴보는 시간 가져보겠습니다. 굉장히 독특하시면서도 기대가 되는 분이더군요.
제가 개인적으로 선망하는 그런 인물이죠. 니콜라스 크리스타키스, 미국의 예일대 휴먼 네이처 연구소 소장, 공식 직함은 그렇습니다.
예.
최근 저서는 우리나라 국내에 번역된 건 신의 화살, 원제는 아폴로스 에로우라고 합니다. 코로나 팬데믹을 현재까지 가장 체계적으로 분석한 책이라고 합니다. 이게
네.
이제 제가 하는 말이 아니고 뉴욕타임즈라든지 워싱턴포스트의 서평인데 크리스타키스 교수는 하버드 의대를 졸업한 의학 박사입니다.
일단 의학으로 시작해서.
그리고
예.
그다음에 펜실베니아 대학에서 사회학을 공부한 사회학 박사이기도 합니다. 그래서
저는 이런 분들 참 싫어해요.
그렇죠.
일가구 이주택을 보는 느낌이에요.
정말 대단한 분이네.
아, 싫어.
조금 더 폼나는 표현으로는 통섭의 지식인이고요. 르네상스적인 인간입니다. 사실 그래서 지금 우리가 알고 있는 팬데믹은 이코노미스트의 영역이 아닙니다. 애널리스트 영역도 아니고 경제석학이 설명해 주기에는 늘 부족한 영역입니다.
예.
그래서 이런 어떤 자연과학과 사회과학, 특히 의학과 사회학을 한 통섭의 지식인한테
예.
우리가 어디에 서 있고 앞으로 이놈의 사태가 이놈의 바이러스가 어디까지
갈 것인지를
물어보는 시간. 이거는 우리 국내 투자자들에게 가장 필요한 시간일 수 있게 제가 좀 목소리가 좀 들떠 있지 않습니까?
네. 웬만하면 이 인터뷰 앞서서
네.
니네 이거 잘 들고 잘 봐야 된다. 그런 얘기는 웬만하면 잘 안 하시는데.
저도 자존심이 있습니다.
늘 촌스러워 하시니까. 그런데
네.
오늘 거는 정말
굉장히
거의 홈쇼핑 호스트처럼 파시네요.
아 그래요? 여러분 그렇게 느끼셨더라면 진짜입니다. 그럼 팩트입니다.
네.
사실 기분 좋습니다. 이런 분을 제가 인터뷰를 할 수 있다라는 게
예.
선뜻 또 여러분도 아마 그 에너제틱한 설명에 놀라실 수 있겠습니다.
예. 얼른 만나보죠. 예일대학교 휴먼 네이처 연구소의 크리스타키스 교수 바로 연결해서 만나보겠습니다.
크리스타 교수님, 아유 반갑습니다. 사실 개인적으로 이건 영광이기도 하고요. 자연과학과 사회과학을 동시에 섭렵한 그런 인물을 인터뷰하게 돼서 기분이 너무 기쁩니다. 사실. 자, 교수님 어떻게 그 의학과 사회학을 같이 하실 수 있을까요? 서로 다른 영역인데 정반대 영역인데.
Yeah, well, you know, when I went to medical school, I wanted to be a surgeon. But very quickly, I discovered that even though surgery was very effective, you only treated one patient at a time. And I was much more interested in issues of population health, like how did large numbers of people get sick in a society as a whole? And what could be done about that? I was very interested in issues of public health. How can we improve the health of society in general, not just one patient at a time? And so I decided to get additional training in the social sciences. And I was at Harvard Medical School at the time. I finished Harvard Medical School in 1989, and then I decided to get a PhD in sociology, which I got in 1995. And it was during that training that I learned about network science, which is very computationally intense, mathematically demanding a field of inquiry. So after I took my first job at the University of Chicago, in 1995, I began working in network science very earnestly. So I've been working in network science for about 25 years now.
앞으로 팬데믹이 어떤 식으로 확대되어 갈지 아니면 인류가 컨트롤할 수 있는 질병이 되어 갈지 이제 그게 가장 뭐 걱정스럽기도 하고 궁금한 질문이기도 해서 교수님 생각이 어떠신지 그것도 좀 여쭤보죠. 앞으로 이 팬데믹이 어떻게 진행될 걸로 보십니까?
Many people mistake the economic shock. They think that the economic collapse is something we are doing to ourselves. This is a false impression. Actually, it's the germ that's doing it to us. It's not the government response. If anything, the government response is reducing the impact because you can't have an economy if people are dying or are afraid to interact socially with each other. So, but your narrow question on the phases of the epidemic, I discussed that in the book, and I have to say that so far, the things are happening as I predicted, which is that there are typically three phases of a serious epidemic. The immediate phase is the initial biological and epidemiological shock of the virus. That's when the virus first enters the human population. And you have to think about it from evolutionary biology perspective. The virus is having what is known as an ecological release. It's like an invasive species released onto an island, like rats on a new island that overrun the place. That's what our bodies are, the island to the virus, which is the rats. The virus, we have no natural immunity to this. It's just going to spread and spread and spread in the human population until it saturates the terrain, which is us. Until it reaches, that is to say, this important threshold of herd immunity, which is until enough people are infected with the pathogen or immunized with a vaccine, such that collectively we have some kind of immunity. Now, the herd immunity topic, I'm sure many of your listeners understand this topic, but it is the idea that a group of people can be immune to a condition, even if not every individual is immune. For example, if you vaccinate 96% of the people against measles, if one of the remaining 4% of unimmunized people gets the measles, you do not have an outbreak because they can't spread it to anyone. They're surrounded by people who are immune. That 96% threshold is the herd immunity threshold. And you should have the intuition that the more infectious the disease is, the more easily it spreads, the higher that number should be. So what happens in the first phase of the epidemic is the virus spreads and spreads and spreads through the population until this threshold is reached. And then the virus still exists. The virus is not eradicated. It'll still kill people. It'll still cause damage, but its epidemic force has been broken. And then that ends the immediate phase.
초기 단계가 언제쯤 교수님이 생각 말씀하신 초기 단계는 언제쯤 끝날까요? 그다음 그리고 그다음 단계는 어떤 단계일까요, 교수님?
And I had predicted 2 years ago that this would last about 2 years into 2022, and we're still on schedule for that. In other words, sometime in the next 12 months, we will reach the end of the immediate phase of the epidemic. Because we've either immunized enough people with a vaccine or enough people have gotten naturally sick that enough people are immune to the condition. And then we will enter the intermediate phase. And that is when we experience the psychological, social, economic, and clinical shock of the virus. And this is based on a look at historical epidemics going back thousands of years, because you have to think about it like a tsunami. Right, like when the tsunami washes up on the shore, it causes devastation, and then the waters recede, but now you've got to clean up the mess, right? Okay, great, the wave is gone, but the houses are destroyed, the roads are destroyed, the people are suffering, they have migrated because of the waves, so we have to clean up the mess. And that's the intermediate phase of the epidemic, where we're going to have to respond to the consequences, the social, economic, psychological, and clinical consequences. And that'll last a couple of years until around 2024.
2022년까지는 초기 단계로 전염병이 발병을 해서 확산하고 그다음 사람을 죽이고 또 변이가 발생하고 하는 그 초기 단계가 내년에나 끝날 수 있다라고 하네요.
일단은 먼저 우리가 당하는 단계가
초기 단계.
두 번째 단계는 우리가 복구하고 저항하는 단계.
그렇죠. 그 단계는 2024년까지.
야, 지금 거의 저항해서 반전에 성공해서 우리가 이기고 있는 거라고 생각하고 있는데.
너무 기대가 팬데믹에서 벗어나고 싶은 기대 심리 때문에 우리가 성급해진 건 아닐까요? 사실 바이러스의 역사를 통해서 본다라면은 긴 스케줄일 수도 있죠.
뭐 좀 여쭤보죠. 그럼 마지막 단계에 대해서. 네. 교수님, 그러면 중간 단계까지는 뭐 전쟁이 나고 나면 이제 전후 복구 단계와 비슷한 것 같은데 그 이후에 펼쳐지는 마지막 단계는 어떤 일이 발생할 걸로 보십니까?
And then I think we're going to have a kind of a roaring 20s, like a kind of a big party basically, because what's going to happen then is it's going to be like, I think, the 21st century version of the 1918 influenza pandemic, you know, after the 19 influenza pandemic, we had the roaring 20s, because I think what's going to happen is people, and we're seeing some hints of that already. What's happening is around the world, people are staying at home. They're withdrawing socially. They're saving their money, right? People during plagues, people become risk averse. Either they don't have a job, so that have no money, or there's nowhere to spend the money because the economy has stopped, or they're worried about the future, so they save their money. So for all these reasons, economic spending declines. That's why you have the public sector steps in, government step in. But anyway, and so people have saved their money and they've avoided social interactions. But now when everything is over, the plague is over, the social economic recovery is taking foot, people will party. They will begin spending their money. They will relentlessly seek out social interactions in nightclubs and restaurants and bars and sporting events. We might see some sexual licentiousness, right? There might be a liberalization of sexual norms in the society. My sister says I have to be very careful to say that this only applies to unmarried couples. Married couples, she says, will not see these changes. So those are the three phases: the immediate phase, the intermediate phase, and the post-pandemic phase. And these are the approximate dates.
죄송합니다. 엄중한 얘기를 하고 있는 동안에 웃음을 짓게 하는데요. Roaring 1920s.
Roaring
1920s라고 얘기를 합니다.
예.
근데 그런 시대에는 우리 금융의 역사, 투자의 역사에서도 1920년대를 요란한 시대라고 합니다. 아, 주가가 급등했었고. 그리고 29년 대공황으로 막을 내렸죠.
네.
근데 그때까지 1918년 스페인 독감이 창궐한 다음에 1929년 대공황이 발생할 때까지 그때를 미국 사람들은 미국의 역사가들은 재즈의 시대라고 부르기도 하고요. 그 시대에 풍미했던 그 시대를 고스란히 보여준 소설이 위대한 개츠비. 성공과 욕망과 네. 돈을 쫓은 개츠비의 그 어떤 분화방 같은 일생을 다룬 소설이죠.
예.
그런 시대는 이제 그런 시대가 올 수 있다는 거죠. 그리고 제가 빙긋이 웃었습니다만 엄중한 얘기를 하는데 빙긋이 웃었습니다만은 어떤 기존의 성적 그 섹슈얼 모럴리티가 무너질 수 있다라고 얘기를 하네요.
그게 바이러스랑 무슨 관계가 있길래 그런 거죠?
크리스타키 교수의 설명대로
예.
서로 이 소셜 액티비티스가 줄어들고 만남이 줄고 사회적 거리두기 때문에 그다음에 소비도 줄고 전체적으로 억눌렸던 욕망이 3단계 즈음에서 폭발할 것이다.
그건 갇혀 있고 아이솔레이트 되어 있던 이런 상황에서 그렇죠. 뭔가 탈출구를 인류는 찾을 텐데
예.
그 분출의 형태가
그렇죠. 왕성한 소비와 성공을 쫓는 야망, 야망을 쫓는 어떤 그 뭐랄까 도전, 대시 그리고 그 기존 성윤리의 퇴색이라고
예상한다.
그렇죠. 교수님, 근데 최근에 델타 변이 때문에 세계가 지금 바짝 긴장하고 있습니다. 이 델타 변이 바이러스 때문에 교수님이 예상한 초기 단계, 1단계가 예상보다 길어지지 않을까요? 어떨까요, 교수님?
A lot depends, however, on the emergence of these new variants. So the Delta variant has an R-naught of 6. So the herd immunity threshold for Delta is 6 minus 1 divided by 6 is about 83%. That means we have to vaccinate a very large fraction of our population in order to be protected against those strains. That's the first point. The second thing is, if variants emerge that can evade our vaccines, so far we have not seen substantial evasion. So, but if a variant emerges that for which our current vaccines are not effective, and I think the probability of that is between 1 and 10%. But if that bad thing were to happen, then all bets are off. We'd be back at the beginning of the epidemic. And all the phases that I just described would be postponed. You know, I would say that we are not at the beginning of the end of this pandemic, although I do think we are at the end of the beginning.
교수님, 투자자들은 앞으로 또 이 팬데믹 같은 사건이 또 발생할 거냐. 이게 가장 좀 궁금한 것 같습니다. 꼭 같은 바이러스가 아니더라도 앞으로는 일정한 주기를 두고 이런 질병의 창궐, 뭐 팬데믹의 반복 이런 게 계속 있을까요? 아니면 이번이 이제 일회성 사건이라고 봐야 되겠습니까?
Well, it's difficult to say because these are stochastic events, right? These are probabilistic events. If you look at the last 100 or 200 or 300 years, we have respiratory pandemics every 10 or 20 years on average, but it varies. Sometimes they come every 2 years, sometimes every 15 years, but every 10 or 20 years. And we have serious respiratory pandemics like the one we're having now every 50 to 100 years. And almost all of these epidemics are zoonotic. They come from animals. They start in animals and spread to us. That's zoonotic. There's some evidence that zoonotic infections are rising in general because of climate change and population growth and forest destruction. Basically, people are coming into more and more contact with wild animals around the world. And therefore, we come into contact with the germs that affect wild animals. And those germs spread to us. And so there's some evidence over the last 50 years that we are seeing more and more zoonotic infections. I mean, that's true, we are. So some people speculate that the interpandemic spell, the time between serious pandemics, is shortening from every 50 to 100 years to every 20 to 50 years. So you're right, we could have another serious pandemic like this in our lifetimes. Now, it could happen at any time. It could happen in 2 years, in 5 years, in 30 years, or in 50 years. It's impossible to know. But there is some suggestion, some data, that the time interval is shortening for these types of respiratory pandemics.
비관적이네요. 뭐 주기가 좀 짧아지고 있다. 다른 동료 학자들의 의견을 빌어서 설명을 하는데 그 가능성에 대해서 얼핏 인정하는 듯합니다.
예.
제가 인종주의자로 비칠까 봐서 자제하고 있는 질문, 자제해왔던 질문인데요. 사실 왜 홍콩 바이러스나 아니면은 과거에 거슬러 올라간다라면 흑사병까지 어떤 글로벌 팬데믹 가운데 상당수가 중국에서 발생했습니다. 왜 그럴까요?
Now on the influenza pandemics, the Chinese have been taking a number of steps. People ask, why do so many of these respiratory pandemics originate in China? Well, first of all, these pandemics start everywhere. They started in all parts of the globe, not just in China or in Asia. For example, the 1918 influenza pandemic probably began in the United States, actually in Kansas, probably. And there are other pandemics that have begun all over the world. But China is, of course, an enormous country. So it's not surprising that more pandemics start in China. Second, it's a very densely populated country. So and it's a very agrarian as well country. And even the Chinese are beginning to express concern about some of the culinary practices. For example, after COVID-19 came out, the Ministry of Agriculture of China released some reports that said, we need to modernize the food industry in China. Because although we have this magnificent ancient cuisine where we eat everything, which is amazing, it might not be such a good idea in the 21st century, for us to do that. So there are a number of reasons that these epidemics start. So the influenza often, not always. For example, the 2009 H1N1 pandemic probably began in Mexico. So I have to be clear that they don't all start in China, but nevertheless, most do or many do. And so as the Chinese government begins to modify or implement some procedures, that may reduce the risk of respiratory pandemics. And plus we have the whole issue of biosafety. I think it's unlikely. I think of the two competing theories about the origins of this virus, the lab leak theory that it was a coronavirus sample collected naturally, brought to the laboratory for study, and then accidentally leaked, or the zoonotic leap theory, that is to say, some farmer somewhere in, might not have been in Wuhan, somewhere in China, interacted with a bat, got infected, spread it to some humans, and then the epidemic took off in probably in the fall of 2019. We have some evidence in my laboratory from some analyses that we've done that probably the first person to leave Wuhan who was already infected probably took place in October, in early October of 2019. So of those two theories, I still think the zoonotic leap is more likely. I think it's it is more likely than the lab leak possibility, although we can't be sure at this point. Regardless, in addition to, as a world, in addition to taking a number of steps to reduce the risk of zoonotic leaps, and in addition to multilateral procedures that will be required to monitor for new zoonotic leaps around the world, and we can talk about that if you're interested, I also think probably every country in the world is re-examining biosafety, right? To like make sure to minimize the risk of this, you know, if of it ever leaking again. So those things will affect our the interpandemic spell. Those kinds of changes in our human response might help us not have them as often, these pandemics as often.
산림의 훼손, 자연의 황폐와 산업화의 결과에 의해서 동물과 인간의 접촉 빈도가 높아진 덕분이다. 예. 높아졌기 때문이다라고 설명을 합니다.
네, 교수님은 또 의학을 전공하신 분이니까 바이러스가 앞으로 어떻게 진화, 변화할지에 대해서도 좀 생각이 있으실 것 같아서 좀 여쭤보죠. 교수님, 저 이번 바이러스도 델타 변이라고 해서 변이 바이러스가 또 창궐을 한 차례 하고 있고 앞으로 대개는 그러나 이런 바이러스들은 시간이 지나면서 독성이 뭐 약해지거나 전염성이 약해지거나 이제 그렇다고는 들었는데 이번은 좀 예외인 것 같기도 하고요. 코로나 바이러스 자체에 대해서는 교수님 의견이 어떻습니까?
With time, over the long term, the host-parasite relationship, there's this like Darwinian competition, because you see that the pathogen doesn't want to kill us, right? It's not in its interest for us to die. What it really wants is for it's to make us sick and make us keep moving around and infect other hosts, right? If it makes us so sick that we die right away, then we don't infect anyone else. That's not good for the pathogen. And if it makes us so sick we stay home in bed and don't interact with anyone, that's also not good. So generally speaking, there's this theory that milder strains, less deadly strains of the pathogen over time come to predominate. And we've seen evidence for that with prior respiratory diseases. However, over the short term, all bets are off. The pathogen can do anything it wants. And so what we're seeing with coronavirus is the opposite. We're seeing more infectious strains. That's not surprising. It's the pathogen's interest to spread more easily. And the way we are, as a world, the way we are responding to the epidemic by incomplete and patchy immunization is creating the Darwinian circumstances to accelerate the emergence of more spreadable and perhaps vaccine-evading strains. In other words, what we really want to do is vaccinate everyone right away, because that reduces the risk that the virus can mutate to be better. But anyway, over the short term, what we're seeing is we're seeing the emergence of more infectious and more lethal strains. So both the Alpha strain from the UK and the Delta strain, which was first noted in India, have higher lethality, are more deadly than the original Wuhan strain. So yes, over the long term, I think what's going to happen with this virus is that it's going to become endemic. It's just going to become another one of those viruses that circulates in humans. We will be exposed to it as children, or will be immunized with vaccines. So you'll be exposed to it as children. You get a mild version of the illness. And then you'll have some immunity for the rest of your life. You'll periodically be re-exposed to it. And because you're re-exposed as an adult who previously as a child had a mild illness, now you'll have a mild illness and you won't die. So it'll be a little bit like the flu, for example. And I think that's what's going to happen eventually with coronavirus, most likely to happen. And but in the short term, all kinds of other bad things could happen, in fact.
숙주가 죽으면 바이러스도 죽지 않습니까? 네. 교수 크리스타 교수는 그렇게 설명을 하네요. 그건 바이러스가 원치 않은 상황이라고 합니다. 그렇다면 숙주와 바이러스 자신이 공존하는 길을 택하게 되는데 그 기간이 생각보다 길다라고 설명을 하시네요. 치명적이거나 더 독성이 높은 그 변이가 발생할 수 있고 그러나 장기적으로는 인간과 공존할 수 있는 게 일반적인 패턴이다.
치명적인 바이러스라면 숙주가 빨리 죽기 때문에.
그렇죠. 자기도 죽지 않습니까?
걸리자마자 바로 침대에 쓰러져서 자꾸 사경을 헤매면 다른 사람 만나서 퍼뜨리기가 어려우니까. 그렇죠. 그런 바이러스는 강할 수는 있으나 오래 번지지는 못한다는 그렇죠. 뭐 일반론인데 예. 이런 가능성 저런 가능성 다 열려둬야 된다는 말씀인 것 같아요.
그렇죠. 그리고 우리가 생각하는 바이러스의 독성이 약해지는 과거의 패턴이 실제로 이번 팬데믹에서 나타나기까지는 시간이 더 걸린다.
예.
시간이 더 필요하다라는 것 같습니다.
예.
I don't think it's a stable. It's not stable right now. I mean, we're seeing multiple variants of concern. Some are, you see, the thing is, we also don't hear about the milder variants. So the emergence of mild variants, they don't come to attention. They're not sick. They don't go to the hospital. No one bothers to sequence them. So we only hear about, well, it's not true exactly, but we mostly hear about the serious ones that are worse. So, so it's very difficult to know exactly where we are right now in the evolution of the virus. There's a big debate right now about how likely is it that a vaccine-evading strain could emerge. And I mentioned that earlier, and I put the probability at 1 to 10%. The reason I think the debate is that, on the one hand, by partially immunizing the population, like, look, just let me step back. Imagine you're a herd of antelope, and you run fast, and a lion is trying to kill you, catch and kill a member of your herd, okay? If the lion, if there are no lions and you're not being predated, the antelope continue running at the speed they were running before. There's no reason for them to be able to run faster. And if a lion kills everyone in the herd, then also the antelope don't evolve to run faster. But if the lion kills only the slow members of the herd and applies a selection pressure, the Darwinian selection pressure, then the remaining members of the herd who were faster runners reproduce more. And over time, the antelope become faster and faster and faster. Of course, the lion also has to evolve to be faster. So you have this predator-prey dynamic. By applying incomplete vaccination in our world right now, we are like the lion. So we are doing exactly the thing that's going to make the virus evolve to avoid us, right? If we vaccinated nobody, then there'd be no reason for the virus to evolve to evade the vaccine. And if we vaccinated everybody, the virus wouldn't have the opportunity to evolve to evade the vaccine. But by vaccinating some people and slowly, we create the circumstances where the virus can, those variants of the virus that are able to just evade the vaccine can become more numerous, like the antelope evolving to be faster. There is a debate right now about what is the probability that we will get vaccine evading strains of the virus evolve. So on the one hand, some people say our incomplete and patchy vaccination is dangerous and is going to create a worse variant of the virus that evades the vaccines. On the other hand, other people say, look, it's already been a year and a half. We have hundreds of millions of people vaccinated. We have billions of people that have been at risk for the virus, and we haven't seen it yet. We have not yet seen it. So that suggests probably it's never going to appear. So we don't know the answer. And it's hard to benchmark the probability. So my feeling is it's unlikely, but not zero, that we will get a vaccine-evading strain of the virus.
교수님, 책을 읽다 보니 흥미로운 개념이 나왔습니다. 맥큐언 가설. 역사적으로 팬데믹을 조사해 보니 약물적 개입, 이른바 백신이나 치료제, 치료약이 나오기 전에 인간이 청소를 하거나 위생생활을 개선하는 등 사회적 경제적 활동에 의해서 많이 뭐랄까 팬데믹이 한풀 꺾인 다음에서야 약물적 개입이 효과를 발휘하더라라는 것 같습니다. 제가 제대로 이해를 했는지요. 이 맥큐언 가설이 사실은 좀 우리의 상식과 좀 다른데 어떤가요, 교수님? 무슨 의미인가요, 이 말이?
No, the evidence in favor of the McEwen hypothesis is very compelling, and that is that typically infectious diseases over history have most of their decline before we invent a vaccine or a drug to treat the condition. And the reason is that infectious diseases respond to socioeconomic conditions. So poor people and poor countries and countries with bad hygiene historically have been the ones that suffered infectious diseases. And so as we got richer and as we cleaned up the environment, we have a dramatic decline in infectious disease. And then eventually we invent a vaccine or a drug for that disease, but that's not really what stopped the problem. That was a late development. Now, the thing about coronavirus is it's a little different because we invented a vaccine so rapidly, you know, that, and there are exceptions to the McEwen hypothesis. For example, penicillin was an astonishing invention that had a detectable effect on pneumococcal pneumonia. So it's not a rule, it doesn't always apply, but it's a generalization that usually applies. That the main thing that reduces infectious disease is socioeconomic response, not pharmaceutical response. The McEwen hypothesis relates to the relative importance of pharmaceutical responses compared to non-pharmaceutical socioeconomic responses to pathogens historically.
사실 우리가 백신이나 치료제가 나오면 네. 질병이 퇴치된다라고 실제로 지금 현재 그 백신을
기대하고 있죠.
예, 기대하고 예. 있죠. 그런데 역사적으로 보면은 백신이 이 인구 만약에 예를 든다면 만 명당 사망자 수가 급격히 증가했다가 확 떨어진 이후에나 대부분 치료제나 백신이 나왔다는 겁니다. 그 이전에 인간은 위생 상태를 그러니까 손을 잘 씻는다든지 거리두기를 예, 한다든지 예. 사회적 경제적 노력을 통해서
먼저 하고 우리가 마스크 먼저 썼잖아요.
예, 그래서. 그렇죠. 그래서 우리가 여기 물론 그 저기 크리스타키 교수도 백신 지금 최근은 우리 코로나 백신은 또 과거보다 굉장히 빨리 나왔다고 하네요. 과거의 백신보다도. 그런 측면에서 본다라면은 여전히 사회적 거리두기, 마스크 쓰기, 그다음에 이런 사회적인 노력도 충분히 병행돼야 된다. 백신만이 만능은 아니다라는 말씀인 것 같습니다.
네.
Now, what is going to break the back of COVID-19? I don't yet know, but I would still bet the vaccines are going to be enormously important in this pandemic. And I also think with the mRNA technology, we'll be able to invent boosters that are targeted at new variants. Now, the problem is the conversation about boosters right now is about giving you a booster of the existing vaccine. But really, the more interesting conversation is boosters, new boosters that are designed to target new variants. And there'll be some delay in manufacturing and inventing those. So as the new variants emerge, but we can use, because of our adenovirus and mRNA platforms, we can rapidly prototype and invent new vaccines. And so if a variant of concern, for example, if a new variant emerges that evades the prior vaccine or that is much more deadly, we'll be able to invent new vaccines for that. It'll take some time, there'll be a lag, but thank God we'll be able to invent new vaccines for that. Most pandemics leave a mark on a society. And I discussed that in the book, you know, bubonic plague, smallpox, HIV, all of these epidemics have affected the society and leave a mark. For example, in the case of HIV, I think people are using condoms a lot more in our society now than they were 20 years ago before HIV, even if they're not at special risk. You know, so I think it changed. Or in the case of influenza, the 1918 pandemic, there were all these little changes in our society and public health interventions and so on that related to that. But I think the big lesson from history, from plagues, is that life always returns to normal. I mean, the plague will end. Life will eventually return to normal. 10 years from now, you know, whenever, life will return to normal. There'll be some echoes. You know, for example, we'll see Zoom technology and drone delivery technology and mRNA vaccine technology. There'll be some technologies that we'll look back and say, oh, those were accelerated by the plague. But by and large, the history of human society is that, you know, our societies returned to normal. There were plagues that afflicted Korea in the historical past, and yet Korean society recovered. Over the short term, however, there's going to be more disruption, and there'll be more changes, you know, in educational systems, in business processes, in leisure travel, for example. You know, I think that the entertainment industry is going to be radically affected. I think the pharmaceutical industry is going to be affected. I mean, I think there are a number of industries that are going to experience economic shocks that are still going to echo for the next few years.
이 프로 어떻게 들으셨어요? 이 자연과학 공부했지 않습니까?
제가 그동안 이제 팬데믹이 앞으로 어떻게 흘러갈 것인지에 대한 예측을
예.
지금 제가 생각해보니까 경제 전문가들
네.
좀 더 좁히면
네.
다양한 그 시장의 기대를 담고 있는 시장 전문가들에게만 주로 들었던 게 아닌가 싶은 생각이
그렇죠.
드네요. 그러니까 뭔가 그거에서 좀 멀찍이 떨어져 있어서 어떤 질병을 의학적인 관점, 사회적인 관점으로 보고
네.
그 근거를 역사에서 찾는 분의 이야기를
네.
그러고 보니까 그동안 못 들었던 것 같은.
사실 그래서 이분에게 이메일을 띄울 때
네.
제가
예.
약간 그런 느낌이 있거든요. 이 인터뷰는 했다 하면 대성공이다. 사실 하면서 그 아까 우리 그 크리스타키 교수의 설명하는 방식도 굉장히 그 활달하게 설명을 하지 않습니까?
예, 예.
그래서 의사들 그러니까 편견인지 모르겠습니다만 의학만을 전공한 사람들은 커뮤니케이션 능력이 좀 약할 때가 있고 그래서 사회학을 겸비한 사회학 박사 학위를 가지고 있으면서 저술도 하고 학교에서 가르치고 그러니까 소통의 능력이 뛰어난 분이라는 생각이 들었습니다.
네.
그렇다면 일반 투자자들에게 훨씬 친근한 이해하기 편한 말로 설명해 줄 수 있을 것 같다.
예.
그리고 통영과 다른 얘기도 들을 수 있을 것 같다는 기대. 사실 그 기대가 채워졌습니다. 어떤가요, 투자자들 여러분?
그럼요. 사실은 3프로 TV를 통념과 다른 이야기를 듣기 위해서 보시는 분들이 대부분일 거예요.
그래요.
네.
저도 사실 그런 부분은 많이 느꼈습니다. 간접적으로.
통념과 다른 이야기가 갖고 있는 가치가 이제 점점 커지고 있고.
그렇죠.
그래서 그것을 찾고 있는 여러분들께 저희도 또 그런 포커스로 앞으로도 계속 인터뷰들 찾아서 여러분께 대령하겠습니다. 네, 뭐 인터뷰는 여기서 좀 마무리하고 인사를 드려야 되겠네요. 교수님, 정말 오랜만에 지적 즐거움이란 어떤 것인가를 또 경험하게 된 것 같고 또 우리 인식의 지평을 이런 계기를 통해서 넓혀주셔서 정말 고맙습니다.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you.
그 여러 인간의 본능이라는 게 있잖아요. 예를 들면 생식의 본능 이런 게 있으니까 이제 인간이 퍼지는 거 아니겠습니까? 그런데 인간의 본능 중에 자기가 알고 있는 것을 남에게 알려주고 싶은 본능이 있는 것 같아요. 아니, 그게 없었으면 어떻게 할 뻔했나? 그러니까 본인 이것만 갖고 있고 끄덕끄덕 한 후에 나만 알고 있어야지라고 생각하면
지식공유는 안 되죠.
이걸 어떻게 뭐 간지럽혀서 하겠어요? 아니면 그러나 또 이렇게 진심으로 부탁을 하면 국경을 넘고 국적을 넘어서 지혜를 나눠주고자 하는 게 이제 인류의 보편적인 심상이라는 게 이런 일을 하는 저희로서는 매우 다행입니다.
이 프로 근데 오늘 네. 그 런지지가 자연과학도 답지 않게 굉장히 심미적인데
사실 저야 뭐 등록금만 공대에 냈죠. 사실은
순간순간 네. 반응해 주는 게
예.
사실 같이 진행하면서 이 프로의 그 순간 재치에 제가 사실 가끔 가위눌림을 당하지만은 덕분에 제가 많이 배웁니다.
그래서 오늘도 중요한 인터뷰 잘 모셔주셔서 늘 고맙게 생각합니다. 네. 강남규 기자님도
예.
복 받으실 거예요. 언제 받으실지는 모르겠습니다만.
그 복이 어디쯤 가 있을까요? 어디쯤 오고 있을까요? 아니, 사실 3프로 독자, 구독자와 그 다음에 저희 중앙일보 구독자들과 영상으로 만나는 사실 이 즐거움도
예.
지식을 쉐어하는, 지식을 공유하는 하나의 그 즐거움만큼이 즐겁습니다. 사실. 네. 감사합니다.
네, 고맙습니다. 네. 시청자 여러분, 저희는 또 다음 인터뷰를 찾아서 또 밀림을 헤매고
네.
초원을 샅샅이 뒤져서
예.
물어보겠습니다. 다음 주에 뵙죠. 고맙습니다.
감사합니다.
긴 연휴 공부 한번 제대로 해보실까요? 딱 한 달 업종 기초교육과 매매 기술을 한 번에 배울 수 있는 올인원 패키지. 업종 분석으로 기초를 다지고 매매 기술로 투자의 날개를 달아보세요. 자세한 내용은 페이지 2 공지사항을 확인하세요.